Freedom House, welcome back to the second part of A Kingdom Perspective on Coronavirus. We both agree as we sit up here that this topic is absolutely essential for us to understand as we navigate these times, and we are so excited that we believe that we're giving you some meaty stuff biblically and practically as we journey together through this time. What we want to do is, as we consider this big idea, navigate through a prophetic, practical, and responsible perspective of journeying through this season. So Alexander, why don't you kick us off as we look at those three things together?
Thanks, Ryan. And again, it's good to be with you. So kind of as a bridge between what we spoke about in the first part, the kingdom framework or understanding how to think through this pandemic, how to respond to it from a kingdom perspective without going into either extremes that we are tend to be pulled into, but to keep the radical middle of the kingdom as we understand it. So as a bridge between that and what we're now going to talk about, more prophetic, practical side, I just want to share a quote with you from Martin Luther. So Martin Luther in the 1600s or late 1500s faced the bubonic plague in Europe, and he wrote a lengthy tract of about 5 or 6 pages in answer to some of the German Lutheran pastors that were sending letters to him as to how they should respond pastorally within their context. And this is just one quote out of a lengthy tract that for me is actually really pretty kingdom, although he doesn't use kingdom language. But just listen to this in terms of the conviction, the tone, and the balance, and the practical realism. I shall ask God mercifully to protect us, firstly. Then secondly, I shall fumigate, help to purify the air, and administer medicine and take it. Then, thirdly, I will avoid places and persons where my presence is not needed, in order not to become contaminated and thus perchance inflict and pollute other people, and so cause death as a result of my negligence. What practical realism is that?
Yeah.
If God should wish to take me, he will surely find me, and I then will have done what he has expected of me, and so I am not responsible for either my own death or for the death of others. But if my neighbor needs me, however, I shall not avoid place or person, but I will go freely to that person to help them, as stated above. See, this is such a God-fearing faith of ours, because it is neither brash or foolhardy, but it does not either tempt God. And that is from his annotated letters. I think that's a great piece of advice.
Yeah, I absolutely agree. As we navigate a prophetic / practical response and perspective, I've come to this understanding that as we live practically before God, it is actually a prophetic statement. In other words, I remember this moment in London, walking across Waterloo Bridge. It was an absolutely stunning day, and people were looking quite sad and forlorn. I began to realize that a practical smile is a prophetic statement in a place like that. And I'm convinced that sometimes our practical living is the most spiritual and prophetic response that we could ever live with. That's my personal conviction. But I love what the Passion Translation says, and I want to say that the Passion Translation is an addendum to what I normally read. It's not normally my go-to, but I love what it says in Titus 3 verse 1. Remind people to respect their governmental leaders on every level as law-abiding citizens, and to be ready to fulfill their civic duty.
Wow.
I absolutely love that. Be ready to fulfill their civic duty. and the prophetic understanding that we are citizens of heaven is absolutely crucial for us. And we navigate life with the weapons of our warfare in a lifestyle of faith, but we're here on earth and we have equally a civic duty. Can you speak into some of those things?
Good. A prophetic response is practical, but equally driven by conviction. And the practical and conviction join together in simply upholding and respecting what the government has asked us to do. And that is out of the general, it's for the general good of the nation.
Yes.
So to change behavior is difficult for human beings. You know, in the whole of psychology, how do we change people's behavior? And from a biblical model, it's simply what you believe deeply within you affects your attitudes, comes out your mouth, and eventually does change how you live and how you behave. So behavioral change in this time of 3 weeks of lockdown and perhaps longer is absolutely critical. So we've tried to give you the way we think about this biblically, theologically, which is a framework of faith, which then leads to change of attitude and leads to change of behavior.
Yes.
So our change of attitude, our attitude should really shift to being responsible and practical as witness to others of kingdom people.
Good.
So for me, it means possibly we could talk about two things. There is the internal journey of using this opportunity to deepen our discipleship to Jesus and use isolation to grow with God and the relationships that we have around us in the home. There will become tensions and pressure in the home and relationships in this kind of pressure cooker of 3-4 weeks in isolation.
Yes.
But we can turn to God, deepen our prayer life, deepen meditation, do spiritual practices, talk as a family, do a lot of practical things. In terms of our outward civic duty, as we uphold what is required of us, keep bodily distance, but social solidarity. So a kingdom prophetic response is contacting people, WhatsApping people, phoning people, having video calls. If you can, go do shopping for people, deliver it at the front door. They can pick it up at the front door, bring it in and wash their hands.
Brilliant.
You know, there is so many practical things of love and care and engagement that we can do. That's a prophetic witness to society that Christians actually make a difference.
Good.
And even more so if we do it to strangers, keeping bodily distance, but socially engaging in solidarity. And of course, intercession and prayer.
Absolutely.
Through intercession and prayer, it's deep spiritual social solidarity by taking into our own bodies in prayer the pain and suffering of others. As people suffer in ICU, as the doctors exercise care, all the healthcare givers, with putting their own lives on the line,
yes,
we must pray and intercede.
Absolutely.
That's a great act of kingdom prophetic witness.
Yes.
That the world doesn't see, but the spiritual powers observe.
Absolutely.
And it defeats them. They, yes, get confounded and confused. They lose their power as Christians do that. So many practical things can roll out here.
No, I love that.
I'm going on, Ryan.
No,
I'll just give you a chance.
I love it. I just think God is doing so much in the church globally at this moment. We can chuckle as we look back and go, gosh, the transition from organs in church and worship to live music, etc. How can God use this? You know, and here we are living with all sorts of contemporary styles of worship and music. I think God is so good as we look back at taking whatever we have come up with in our God-given ingenuity, like social media, etc., to move upon and redeem for His kingdom purposes. I think it's small-minded of us, I don't know if you agree with this, but it's small-minded of us to say we have to lay hands on people for God to heal them, or we have to be present in the cabinet to pray for the president. God sent forth His word, both as Jesus, but also as His spoken word to heal people. And we can send all sorts of, you know, virtual handkerchiefs, as we've called it of late, to see God really intervene in moments, you know. I think we are growing and expanding our appetite and capacity for God to move powerfully at this time. And we need to engage with all sorts of practical means and manners to see the kingdom of God come at this time.
Absolutely, Ryan. I would agree. I think that what comes to mind as you speak is Jesus, where the Roman centurion came to him and said, "My servant is suffering at home. Please come and touch him and heal him." And Jesus said, "Actually, I don't need to.
I love that.
Just speak the word." Yes. And he spoke the word and it covers the distance. So, yeah, we have to be careful of teachings, theologies, stuff on Facebook, on the social media that kind of pressurizes us to have to do certain things that actually becomes presumptuous, small-minded, and fundamentalistic. You know, yeah. God can heal anyone, anywhere, at any time. We can pray from home. We can pray with people over the phone. We can pray with people over a video call.
Yes.
We can reach out and from a distance bless people.
Absolutely.
In the Old Testament, when Aaron lifted up his hands and blessed the people, there was a communication of power.
Yes.
That actually is power encounter.
Amen.
So absolutely. I don't have to touch you, no. I can just bless you.
Yeah.
So there are many means to communicate the presence and power of God in healing, in intercession, and speaking the word of faith, declaring healing, commanding healing. We must use the weapons of warfare God
Amen.
Has given us.
Absolutely.
You know, I mean, just imagine if these 3 weeks or 4 weeks of lockdown, we get into becoming a truly prayerful people.
Good.
Where we move invisible things by praying,
yes.
speaking, declaring, proclaiming, worshiping. One of the greatest weapons of warfare is prayer and praise.
That's right.
Is worship.
That's right.
And prayer.
Yes.
And then proclaiming the word of God.
That's right.
So that has lots of applications.
I love that.
Practically.
I hope you are excited by this because I certainly am. I love you alluding to the moment with Jesus, with a Roman centurion.
Yep.
Roman overlord. And Jesus in that moment uses his measure of faith.
That's right.
For an advocate, a symbol of the enemy, as it yeah. were. And he even says, if I remember correctly, "I haven't seen faith like this
That's right.
before."
That's
I, right. I love the fact that God moves on our measure of faith. And I'm encouraged.
Yeah.
He's just looking for a mustard seed of faith.
Well said.
Some practical things I think we need to engage with. Work with me on this and maybe add to it. We really do need to be praying, of course, as you've said, for those at the medical front line. That is a non-negotiable. We need to be praying for that. But equally practically and responsibly as citizens of South Africa, we need to be praying for small and medium enterprises, the SMEs at this time.
That's right.
I know that we've made in Freedom House a list of all known small and medium enterprises,
wow.
and we are regularly, daily praying over those by name and using that as an opportunity to pray through into our region, the North Coast, pray through that into KwaZulu-Natal, pray through that into South Africa. And we are trusting that God would, at this time of potential, well, not potential, but quite a probable downturn in economy, that he would turn everything and that we would supernaturally
Amen.
Have a boom time in Jesus' name. Those are practical things we can engage in.
God help us, yeah. No, absolutely,
yeah.
Ryan. No, as you speak, it just stirs my heart. it really does because, the call to pray for people who will be unemployed, to pray for people who will struggle financially,
yes.
to pray for big business, to pray for bosses,
yes.
to exercise mercy, compassion, make space. This does not need to be negative news of a massive turn down.
Yes.
In the kingdom, by the grace of God, we can make decisive and massive difference.
Yes.
Economically, in business circles, and of course, also we call to pray for the president, for the government as they lead us. I mean, what refreshing different leadership in Ramaphosa.
What a man.
As opposed to the previous dispensation.
Yes.
So really pray for Ramaphosa and the cabinet
yeah.
and all
senior
people.
Ministers.
Yeah, senior
yeah.
ministers. It's really important. Because God can flatten the curve.
Amen.
God can turn the economy. God can do miracles.
Amen.
We do not need to buy the fatalistic view of the worst scenario.
Yes. Yes.
And we are people of faith.
Yes.
So the praying for these things. And also one last thing I want to say, Ryan, if I may.
Please do.
I am very mindful of the privilege that I have, that we have.
Yes.
And especially as white people. People who live in townships, in informal settlements, who have no space to isolate, who are cramped together, the large number of unemployed, the poor in our nation, who will struggle even more economically.
Yes.
And God forbid that the coronavirus breaks out and runs rampant in informal settlements. So we need to really have compassion and mercy and intercede for those who are not privileged as we are.
Yes.
And use our privilege in whichever ways we can practically to help people who are not privileged.
That's right.
And pray for their protection. Intervene in ways that we can practically.
Yes.
And pray that God would withhold this from spreading. I mean, you think of Africa. You think of Africa. And God forbid that it spreads.
Amen.
Throughout Africa. I've heard them say Africa could become the next epicenter as Europe is now. But God forbid.
Yes.
And through our prayers and intercession, our presence and practical engagement, we can make a difference.
That's exactly right. Alexander, so appreciate your time on this. Freedom House, a kingdom perspective, is one which embraces both and, our civic duty as well as our supernatural God-given duty as citizens of heaven. We don't want to live an either-or mentality. We want to embrace both. That's how it is to live as a good believer at this time. We want to encourage you to think correctly, to act correctly, and most importantly, to come into agreement with the Word of God, to be praying. We are anticipating, like you, of incredible miracles that God would do at this time, and that His name would be made famous, that His glory would cover the earth as the waters cover the sea. And everything that He does is for the good of humanity. And may I say this, not just the believers, but those who are yet to become believers. He loves Project Planet Earth. And He wants none to perish. And so, Freedom House, God bless you. Let us rise up with a kingdom perspective in Jesus' name. Amen.